It is Friday, January 8th. Let's talk PlayStation. Hello, everybody. Let's get right into this with our PlayStation Plus reminder. The January games are available right now. That's Greedfall, Shadow of the Tomb Raider, and the PS5 version of Maneater, which if you're still on PS4, remember, make sure you do this, but through desktop or mobile, you can still add that game to your library. That way, when you get a PS5 eventually, you've got some PS5 games waiting for you. Native PS5 games waiting for you. So at this point, you should have Bugsnax and Maneater. Also, for our PlayStation Now update in January, we know what we're getting there. The Crew 2 is now available, and that does have an expiration date of July 5th, 2021. So if you're a current member, make sure you get that playtime in before that date. But more permanent additions, that Surviving Mars, Frostpunk Console Edition, and the Bioshock Collection. So 1, 2, Infinite, and I believe that also includes all the content associated with those games as well. So not too bad there. Decent month, although this is once again another edition where there's some crossover between previous instant game collection games from PS Plus. Rather annoying, but that's why we talked about this on Tuesday, where there does need to be some consolidation options with PS Now and Plus, or making sure that PS Now just offers full online play so you can have some migration there and it doesn't really undermine Plus or really Sony's services. But either way, decent month for PS Now. Anyway, getting into our first news story, Killzone.com was recently shut down, and if you were to visit the site right now, you'd get a message that tells you this, that the Killzone franchise website has retired, and that moving forward, you'll be redirected to PlayStation.com. It does point out that this doesn't affect any online services for, say, Mercenary on Vita or Killzone Shadowfall on PS4, and that is, currently, it doesn't affect it. Mind you, we've done some recent tests where, at least on Vita, annually, we check online services there, and the player base is incredibly small. I recently looked at Shadowfall through PS Now in our PS5 PS Now video, and that was okay, but that's probably got a little more life left in it. But for right now, at least, this isn't a great indicator, considering that the Killzone franchise has been dormant for quite a reasonable amount of time now. And you know, at this point in our Tuesday video where we talked about some PlayStation predictions, I feel that Guerrilla's second project is a new IP and not necessarily, say, another Killzone. So seeing the website have a formal retirement probably isn't the best indicator that we could have another Killzone, right? But at the very least, what Sony's done in recent years with a lot of their IP is their specialized websites just start pointing back to PlayStation.com, so it really doesn't matter what it is. They just get their own special webpage on PlayStation.com now rather than some other separate web address. But for right now, at least, that's what we're dealing with. Moving on to our next news story, there's this blog site called Game of the Year Picks, which, if you don't know, they try to crown an overall winner for Game of the Year amongst all the other games that may have also won the award in the same year. That's what's somewhat problematic around that conversation when it comes to Game of the Year. And I've always found it a bit strange when people ask, you know, what do you think is going to win Game of the Year? Because I've always felt, well, multiple games will probably win because there's multiple sites and publications. And that's kind of what this blog tries to solve here, is that they look at a number and say, well, this game won the most Game of the Year awards. And that's the recent revelation, is that if you look at all the years, and certainly the last three, Sony has won a lot of these for, you know, published games or second party games. So for 2020, Last of Us Part 2 took home the most awards by a lot. 2019 was Death Stranding. That might seem very surprising, actually, and I was certainly surprised by that as well. It just barely beat Resident Evil 2. 2018, God of War, that's probably more understandable. 17 was Breath of the Wild, and I think that's deserved. But then 16, Uncharted 4. So yeah, Sony's got a lot of these titles that are consistently winning. So not only do they catch a bunch of awards from sites and, you know, multiple different categories or overall Game of the Year winners, but they're also taking home the most in total, which is kind of nuts when you really look at it. The site is handy, though. You can get a nice breakdown of each particular year, and you can see all the games throughout the years that you know, have seen the most critical acclaim. But this just kind of goes back to what we often say when it comes to Sony's first party. This is just going back to the reputation and the titles they fund. Same with their new IPs that they often take a shot at and things like that. But yeah, I mean, clearly the company's been doing something right in recent years, and it'll be interesting to see how long they could potentially keep pulling this off. 2021 might be a tough year, considering that there's actually a few games that they're putting out alongside some exciting things from Nintendo, And then who knows, Microsoft can certainly have a pretty big winner next year as well. 2022 might look better for them just for all the acquisitions they've recently done, and games aren't made overnight. So we might be waiting a little bit for some of Microsoft's heavy hitters in 2022. But either way, there's just so much good software to play. Next up, the official Uncharted movie Twitter account shared four new screenshots from the movie. Not all too revealing, just looks like some, you know, typical Uncharted shots there. You've got, you know, a statue and cobwebs, a treasure map, or some kind of map. You'd expect that there'd be some map action in this movie. A weird artifact that turns out to be a key. Typical Uncharted fashion, so there's nothing out of the ordinary just yet, but I think it's... In motion is what we're looking for here. When we get that first trailer, which the trailer can always set an interesting tone for how a movie might turn out to be, but that's where it could also give you that reverse Uno, because once you watch the movie, it's completely different from how the trailer portrayed it. So it's, I don't know, it's it's just another small step in what will hopefully be a good direction for this film. Now, for this story, I really didn't think it would get this much attention, which is why I actually didn't mention it last week, but sure enough, it really blew up. So we'll mention it briefly here, because if you are interested, the pre-orders for this will go up today, just in a few hours from actually watching this, if you're here right away watching the video when it goes live. But anyway, there's a PlayStation 2-themed PlayStation 5 coming out from a third-party company. So they're just buying, you know, consoles themselves and then dressing them up to look like PS2s, kind of. I mean, really, they're just blacked out consoles with the colored PlayStation logo on the controller and on the console itself. You also get colored PlayStation buttons. So, you know, it looks cool. I mean, it's a third party company. I don't know. I found it more interesting that there was another gold PS5 that was announced, which actually I read an estimate for the gold value on that machine, which I think puts it at around $1.8 million or something like that. And I think I titled that news story as several hundreds of thousands of dollars. But really, it was like in the seven-figure range, which is nuts. But either way, if you're interested in these consoles, these will be up for pre-order. There's only going to be about 300 of them available. You can also get the controller separately for about $100. They'll make 500 of those. I imagine these will go out pretty quick, just because it's a PS5 in general, right, which is still pretty hard to get a hold of right now. So they look cool. I'm never really too interested in these third-party offerings. I always like official OEM products, so not my thing, but it's an option for you, and certainly a cool one. For our next news story, Sony's confirmed that for the Japanese market, they're knocking it down to one PS4 model moving forward. So essentially, they're done with PS4 Pro over there, which, remember, we're pretty much expecting that to be worldwide anyway. They haven't formally announced any discontinuation worldwide just yet, but that's probably what's happened. No high-capacity PS4 Slim models, no color variations, just 500 gigs, jet black, and that seems reasonable enough, certainly given the market conditions in Japan. It's reflective of that, I think. I mean, at minimum, we expect the PS4 Slim to be sold and manufactured for at least another 2 years worldwide, but for Japan, this pretty much makes sense, considering that consoles have been on a downward trend there, and I know this goes directly into the conversation of Sony's commitment to that particular market. And well, that's where we can segue nicely into our next news story, which is that for the first time since 1994, in a single year, Sony sold under 1 million PlayStation consoles. And this is partly due to the fact that they weren't allocated many PS5s to begin with. And this is the last year, well, one of the last years of PS4's market relevancy. And this is already a poor market for consoles in general. So this is where you see the console, well, Sony didn't do all that well. And this chart actually is a very good bird's eye view of the entire situation, because you can see where Sony's peak years are PS1 and PS2, where consoles were still fairly strong. And then once we got into PlayStation 3 territory, those years were incredibly bolstered by PSP, where this country loves handhelds. And then you go into PlayStation 4 and it's okay. And that's where you can actually see Vita helping a little bit there as well, because again, that's like the only market where Vita did okay. And then, well, we got to the point where there just wasn't that many PS5s to begin with, so that's where we can see them dip below 1 million units. And it'll be interesting to see what 2021 looks like, because that is where Sony stands right now, is that they no longer have a handheld to flourish in that market. And, you know, they're out of the handheld business. So now we're just looking at strictly the console business for them. And this is where, yeah, I mean, it's going to be rough for them. And I would be surprised to see PlayStation 5 lifetime sales even match PlayStation 4. I think that's where we can see some really telling numbers here. And I know it continuously goes into Sony's commitment to the territory, but you have to remember is that there's just a downward trend, obviously. I mean, you can't force a product into a market where there's no demand, right? So, you know, as much as I would like to see PlayStation 5 succeed in Japan, it's still going to be a decent market for them. It's just that there are certain business strategies that will be employed to, you know, not even leverage, but try to make the most of the situation, right? And I think that's what we're going to see throughout this generation. And it's not going to be, when it comes to press, it's not going to look good. Now, moving on to our next news story, we have some updated rumored PS5 lifetime sales figures. So unfortunately, still not confirmed. But VGChartz is reporting that up to December 26th, PS5 lifetime sales are apparently at 4,480,000 units. So pretty much 4.5 million, about 4.5 million worldwide. Now, we just talked about this in our Tuesday predictions video, where I obviously wanted to surmise that we're probably close to 5 million just so I could look correct. But our last rumored figure was 3.4 million within a month. And then actually VGChartz had a separate report about a week ago or a few days prior to this updated one of 4.5, where it was about 4.2 or 4.3 million, something like that. Obviously, in the last 5 days of 2020, I doubt they sold another 500,000 units. So really what we're looking at is, better numbers than what PS4 did. Sony certainly did manufacture more and they sold more. But that's about 300,000 more than what they did in 2013. So actually, it's pretty disappointing. Not a whole lot more versus PS4. And certainly, this is the situation where if they made enough of these things, they all would have got sold. If they wanted to break a record of 5 million, if they wanted to break a record of 6 million, maybe even 7 million, they probably would have sold all those consoles. It would have been really interesting, actually, if they made so many to the point where it would have been no problem to buy one. That would have, they would have had to start manufacturing way early. But either way, 4.4, really 4.5 is what we're looking at right now for potentially how many consoles Sony has sold so far. Next up, Microsoft recently sent out a survey asking Xbox Series S and X owners how they feel about their consoles. And one of the questions in the survey mentions PlayStation, where it says, "I'm aware of features on PlayStation controllers that I wish were on the controller that came with this console." So not necessarily a direct question, but indirectly asking, do you agree, disagree, things like that. And they're gauging consumer interest about features like haptic feedback and adaptive triggers. Phil Spencer's been pretty forward about this. He's actually impressed with the DualSense and he loves what it can do. And I think to a degree, Microsoft was probably caught off guard by how well the controller is initially being received right now. And that's always the worry with new console generations. There's always some sort of gimmicky, unique aspect of the hardware that maybe it seems cool on the surface, but you know, after a year or two, the support erodes away. Maybe first party will continue using it, but for the most part, third party, you know, lets go of it because they're developing on multiple platforms. They can't really go out of their way to work on one unique hardware feature versus the other platform. So at least right now, the DualSense is well received. We've got a lot of software that's using it in really cool ways. It's a fantastic sensory experience that I think is so much more additive compared to what we've seen before. But in all honesty, this could be the best thing that could happen to the DualSense, because no matter how great it is right now, we don't know what long term will look like. But if Microsoft truly evaluates these features and brings it to the base controller on their machines, which they would have to do for the base controllers, you can't put this on the Elite series where a small fraction of Xbox customers actually buy that. It has to be a base feature amongst all the consoles that they ship. If they were to do that, I mean, then that will be a situation where developers wouldn't have to worry as much, right? They can work on these features between both machines. There can be some similarities to how they work and function, assuming that it's relatively similar to how the DualSense handles it. And we could see some strong support long-term into the life cycle. So quite honestly, I would love to see Microsoft follow through with this. Their controller is great right now. They've been, you know, fairly conservative with the overall shape and design, but for the most part, if it's not broken, don't attempt to fix it. But this might have been an area where they were too conservative, or they played it too safe. Now moving on, I just had to mention this, but it looks like IKEA stores, or at least this one store, is offering mock PS5 and Series X boxes with their dimensions listed, so you can make sure that the machines will fit in whatever furniture you're considering buying. The PS5 even says which IKEA media storage unit will be able to fit my new memeishly oversized gaming console. I saw that and I was dying. It's hilarious, especially considering that the last time I went to an IKEA, which was 2019, so technically the last generation, every staged bedroom or living room or whatever had a mock, well, it was an empty shelled Xbox 360. So like it was the console, but you know, nothing inside of it. And it was all 360s, nothing else, which was strange to me. So nice to see that they've caught up with the times. Now, with all that said, it's time to get to Let's Talk Plus, our weekly Let's Talk PlayStation giveaway, where one of you can win a $10 PSN code. I would like to congratulate this viewer right here. I'll be contacting you very soon via email or Twitter. If you would like to win a $10 PSN code, it's very easy. Follow the link down below. Supporting this channel a number of ways can gain you an entry, and I'll announce the winner next week because I'm trying to pay for your games. Those are all the news stories that I want to talk about with you all. Our Tuesday video was 2021 PlayStation Predictions. Our annual video is up. Check it out. I graded myself from last year, put out some new predictions. Hopefully they're right. I think they're pretty good, but you know, I'm biased here. So of course I want them to be right, but we also have our Tuesday video coming as always. And that is pretty much it. That concludes this week's episode of Let's Talk PlayStation. I'm Ryan Panecki. Thank you all so much for talking with me, and I will see you all next Friday.